Good morning. Today we celebrate the third Sunday of Easter. This Mass is live streamed from St. Anne Catholic Church in Richmond Hill, Georgia.
Shout joyfully to God, all the earth, Alleluia! Sing a song to His name, Alleluia! Praise Him with magnificence, Alleluia! Alleluia! Alleluia!
Therefore I ask Blessed Mary, ever Virgin, all the angels,
brothers and sisters to pray for me to the Lord our God. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
A reading from the Acts of the Apostles. Then Peter stood up with the 11, raised his voice and proclaimed, "You who are Jews, indeed all of you staying in Jerusalem, let this be known to you, and listen to my words. You who are Israelites, hear these words. Jesus the Nazarene was a man commended to you by God with mighty deeds, wonders, and signs which God worked through him in your midst, as you yourselves know. This man, delivered up by the set plan and foreknowledge of God, you killed, using lawless men to crucify him. But God raised him up, releasing him from the throes of death, because it was impossible for him to be held by it. For David says of him, 'I saw the Lord ever before me. With him at my right hand, I shall not be disturbed. Therefore, my heart has been glad, and my tongue has exulted. My flesh too will dwell in hope, because you will not abandon my soul to the netherworld, nor will you suffer your Holy One to see corruption. You have made known to me the paths of life. You will fill me with joy in your presence. My brothers, one can confidently say to you about the patriarch David that he died and was buried, and his tomb is in our midst to this day. But since he was a prophet and knew that God had sworn an oath to him that he would set one of his descendants upon his throne, he foresaw and spoke of the resurrection of the Christ, that neither was he abandoned to the netherworld, nor did he, his flesh, see corruption. God raised Jesus. Of this we are all witnesses. Exalted at the right hand of God, he received the promise of the Holy Spirit from the Father and poured him forth, as you see and hear." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
A reading from the first letter of St. Peter. Beloved, if you invoke as Father him who judges impartially according to each one's works, conduct yourselves with reverence during the time of your sojourning, realizing that you were ransomed from your futile conduct, handed on by your ancestors, not with perishable things like silver or gold, but with the precious blood of Christ, as of a spotless, unblemished lamb. He was known before the foundation of the world, but revealed in the final time for you, who through him believe in God, who raised him from the dead and gave him glory, so that your faith and hope are in God. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Oh. glory to you, O Lord. That very day, the first day of the week, two of Jesus' disciples were going to a village 7 miles from Jerusalem called Emmaus, and they were conversing about all the things that had occurred. And it happened that while they were conversing and debating, Jesus himself drew near and walked with them, but their eyes were prevented from recognizing him. He asked them, "What are you discussing as you walk along?" They stopped, looked downcast. One of them, named Cleopas, said to him in reply, "Are you the only visitor to Jerusalem who does not know of the things that have taken place here in these days?" And he replied to them, "What sort of things?" They said to him, "The things that happened to Jesus the Nazarene, who was a prophet mighty in deed and words before God and all the people, how our chief priests and rulers both handed him over, but we were hoping that he would be the one to redeem Israel. And beside all this, it is now the third day since this took place. Some women from our group, however, have astounded us. They were at the tomb early in the morning and did not find his body. They came back and reported that they had indeed seen a vision of angels who announced that he was alive. Then some of those with us went to the tomb and found things just as the women had described. But him they did not see. And he said to them, 'Oh, how foolish you are, how slow of heart to believe all that the prophet spoke. Was it not necessary that the Christ should suffer from these things and enter into his glory?' Then, beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he interpreted to them what referred to him in all the scriptures. As they approached the village to which they were going, he gave the impression that he was going on farther. But they urged him, 'Stay with us, for it is nearly evening and the day is almost over.' So he went in to stay with them. And it happened that while he was with them at table, he took bread, said a blessing, broke it, and gave it to them. With that, their eyes were open, and they recognized him, but he vanished from their sight. Then they said to each other, 'Were not our hearts burning within us, while he spoke to us on the way and opened the scriptures to us?' So they set out at once and returned to Jerusalem, where they found gathered together the 11 and those with them who were saying, 'The Lord has truly been raised and has appeared to Simon.' Then the two recounted what had taken place on the way and how he was made known to them in the breaking of the bread." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Good morning. Very happy that you are joining us by live stream, but very sad that you are not here in person, and I'm growing a little bit weary of that, not only because I miss you, but I'm worried that you might get too comfortable by watching Mass on live stream rather than being here in person. I especially miss our children, and I want you to know I'm praying for them, especially our second graders who would have made their first communion next Sunday, and our eighth graders who would have been confirmed a week from this coming Wednesday. I know how excited I was to make my first communion 59 years ago, and how disappointed I would have been if church had been canceled, and that would have prevented me from doing so. I was a little bit more nervous about confirmation, which was 2 years later at that time, in 1962, when I was, which is 57 years ago, when I was in the fourth grade. I was nervous because I knew the bishop would be asking us questions, and then in the old ritual of confirmation, the bishop would slap you in the face to remind you that it is difficult to follow Christ in this life, and you have to take spits and buffeting as our Lord did, if you are to be faithful to him and his mission. So I'm sorry that you're not able to be making your first Holy Communion or celebrating confirmation. But God will make things straight eventually. We just have to be patient. I've always been puzzled about why the two men on the road to Emmaus, or the two people, didn't recognize who Jesus was. Maybe they were so grief-stricken, and the scriptures tell us that they had their eyes downcast. They weren't looking at the Lord who walked with them, and therefore they didn't really pay attention to whom it was. Or perhaps Jesus had a different look after his resurrection, a glorified look that maybe transcended the specific look that Jesus had when he walked here on earth. We don't know. The scriptures don't make that clear. But I know often when I go in public, apart from Mass, and see you, let's say at Publix or some other venue, I'm not always sure that it's you, because it could be somebody that looks like you. And so I'm not really sure. And the same is true of me when people see me without my clerical dress on, maybe I'm at the beach wearing a bathing suit or some other venue, they're not sure if it's me or not, because I'm out of the context in which they normally see me. I went to Publix on Thursday, and everybody was wearing masks. And I certainly didn't recognize my parishioners because of that. And somebody said to me from a distance, "Hi, Father Allen." I have no clue as to who that person was. And so it's kind of understandable that the two on the road to Emmaus maybe did not recognize Jesus. But they were also grief-stricken because of what they had lost, and puzzled by what they had heard. And maybe their eyes were filled with tears and they couldn't see through them to see who Christ was in their midst. But God gives us the faith we need to see him today, although he is invisible to us, but present to us in our brothers and sisters, especially those in need, in his word when it is proclaimed and we listen to it and study it, and in the sacraments of the church, especially the most holy Eucharist, the holy sacrifice of the Mass. But there are those elements that prevent us from growing in our faith, and sometimes can weaken and even destroy our faith. And we have to be on guard for those things and beg God to help us to overcome them. I have to tell you, I'm bummed out that this is now, I think, the fifth Sunday that we are in a lockdown position and we cannot invite you to be present at Mass in a physical way. It's very disconcerting to me, as it is to you. And I think that these things can weaken our faith, because we're all asking, "Oh God, if you are God, why don't you do something about this? Why, of all places, is the church closed and Publix opened? What does that mean?" And maybe we're not only disappointed in God in allowing this pandemic to affect us in such negative ways, but maybe we're angry at the church and her leaders and for the inconsistent messages that we're getting, not only from them, but from our political leaders. Maybe we're doubtful that this pandemic is actually as bad as they're saying it is. Maybe we're being manipulated. You know, paranoia can start to enter into our lives when so much has been taken away from us and we're not really sure why or if what is being done is the best course of action. And I certainly believe that the most important medicine that we can receive in this life is our Lord Jesus Christ. And for us not to be able to receive him, his body, blood, soul, and divinity at Mass is certainly a point of consternation for us. But the point is that all of this stuff kind of can weaken our faith. And I think we can understand, too, how the apostles, after Jesus died on the cross, and maybe the two on the road to Emmaus, may have been terribly disappointed by what had occurred. They believed Jesus, during his public ministry, was the Messiah. They thought he would be a political king that would defeat all their political enemies and establish the promised land once again here on earth, once and for all. And maybe they felt that they were duped by God. They were duped by Jesus. They were duped by his apostles. Maybe it was all a great sham. And I think sometimes we might feel that as well. And yet the Lord Jesus is with them nonetheless, walking on the road to Emmaus. And it's interesting to me that they come to recognize him in the breaking of the bread, which is, in fact, the oldest name for the Catholic Mass, the Holy Sacrifice of the Mass, because it goes back to the Gospel of John and this experience on the road to Emmaus, that they came to recognize him in the breaking of the Mass. I'm sorry, in the breaking of the bread. Our Mass is broken because you can't be here, but obviously Jesus is still present with us, even though there's just a handful of essential personnel here to make sure it happens. But all of you are essential, so don't feel denigrated by that either. So we have to recognize the things that can prevent us from recognizing Jesus, but that he is present to us in the breaking of the bread. You know, one of the things that Jesus makes clear in today's gospel is that we are all companions on this pilgrimage of life with its joys, its sufferings, its horrors, its evil, its tragedies. We're all companions together on this journey, and we're called to recognize Jesus in the sacraments of the church, especially the sacrament of the Most Holy Eucharist, in the breaking of the bread. And it's interesting, if you look at the English word for companion, it's cum, which in Latin means with, and panions or panis, which in Latin, the word for bread is panis, with bread, because we are companions when we break bread with one another. Not only in a secular venue such as the dinners that we eat together, the times that we socialize with friends or companions, but most importantly, here at Mass. We are with the Lord in the breaking of the bread. But more importantly, he is with us. The question is, do we recognize him? And what is preventing us from recognizing him now? Perhaps we're anxious about many things. I know I am. The economy seems to be in free fall right now. I know some of you are threatened with the loss of jobs and maybe have already lost those jobs. Maybe the governmental money that is being set aside to help us might run out before we actually get that help. Maybe we're worried about our loved ones coming down with this coronavirus and dying, or we're worried about ourselves getting it and dying. There's a lot of anxiety out there which could prevent us from seeing how the Lord is with us nonetheless. And the great grace that we have at this moment in history to have live streaming masses, that we can participate at least in a virtual way and in our own parish by this miracle of technology, which at its core is always a miracle of the Lord. So as we continue this Mass and break bread as companions on the journey, the pilgrimage to eternal life, because this earth is not our final destination. There is more to come for those who live in Christ and believe in him. Let us ask for the graces that we need for an increase of faith, hope, and love.
I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us men and for our salvation he came down from heaven, and by the Holy Spirit was incarnate of the Virgin Mary and became man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate, he suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins, and I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Let us pray that the church and the world will be renewed by the power of the resurrection of Jesus Christ.
For Pope Francis, Archbishop Hartmeyer, and all the bishops, may they show forth the mercy and love of Jesus Christ crucified and risen, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For peace and justice throughout the world, may all people love and respect the gift of human life from the moment of conception, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the sick, suffering, and dying, may they be healed of affliction of mind, body, and soul, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the legal protection of the unborn and all who are vulnerable, that laws be enacted throughout the world to do so, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all who serve us in heroic ways, from medical personnel to the armed forces, that they may be kept safe and secure from illness, violence, war, and danger, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the safe return to normal life in the church and secular life, that God will hasten to help us, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the happy repose of all the faithful who part, in particular, Mary Harden, Carol and Bob Nichols, Bernard Casson, and Edward Gannon, and Doris McCallum, and for the consolation of those who grieve, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For our parish to persevere in faith during this time of pandemic restrictions, and for the intention of this Mass and our own intention, we offer in silence. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Let us pray the prayer for vocations.
O God, hear our prayer,
and let our cry come unto you.
Bless our diocese of Savannah, with many vocations to the priesthood, diaconate, and religious life. Give the men and women you call, the light to understand your gift, and the love to follow all the footsteps of the priestly Son. Amen.
Grant, Almighty God, that we may celebrate with heartfelt devotion these days of joy despite our present hardships, which we keep in honor of our crucified and risen Lord, who lives and reigns forever and ever.
Amen.
Praise the Lord, O my soul. I will praise the Lord throughout my life. I will sing to my God for as long as I live. Alleluia. Thank you.
have given her cause for such great gladness. Grant also that the gifts we bring may bear fruit in perpetual happiness, through Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you, and with your spirit. Lift up your hearts. We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, all at all times to acclaim you, O Lord, but in this time above all, to laud you yet more gloriously, when Christ our Passover has been sacrificed. Through him the children of light rise to eternal life, and the halls of the heavenly kingdom are thrown open to the faithful. For his death is our ransom from death, and his rising the life of all has risen. Therefore, overcome with paschal joy, every land, every people exalts in your praise, and even the heavenly powers with the angelic hosts sing together the unending hymn of your glory as they acclaim. In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing. He gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it. For this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many, for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me."
Thank you. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb.
Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed.
The Lord has risen and has appeared to Peter. Alleluia.
Oh, my Jesus, I believe that you are present in the most holy sacrament. I love you above all things, and I desire to receive you into my soul. Since I cannot at this moment receive you sacramentally, come at least spiritually into my heart. I embrace you as if you were already there, and unite myself wholly to you. Never permit me to be separated from you. Amen.
The body of Christ.
Amen.
In the town.
may attain their flesh, the incorruptible glory of the resurrection, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
As you know, our bishops of the state of Georgia have requested that we not have public masses throughout May. God willing, they'll open up again in some way in June, perhaps even earlier, depending on how things are going with the opening up in the state of Georgia. So continue to pray that this sheltering in place, as far as Mass is concerned, comes to a quick conclusion. We will continue to live stream our Masses Monday through Friday at 9 a.m. in our chapel, and then on Sunday at 10:30 a.m. here in the main church, and we continue to have our drive-through blessing with Easter water and benediction of the Most Blessed Sacrament around noontime. That comes to a conclusion rather quickly, so please be sure you're on time so that you don't miss it. And we always look forward to seeing you during that procession of cars and that blessing. I'm praying for you, as is Father Solomon. We ask that you would pray for us and pray for all who are in need, and stay in touch with your loved ones and your neighbors and assure them during this time.
The Lord be with you, and with your spirit.
Now then, pray for God's blessing. May God, who by the resurrection of his only begotten Son, was pleased to confer on you the gift of redemption and of adoption, give you gladness by his blessing.
Amen.
May he, by whose redeeming work you have received the gift of everlasting freedom, make you heirs to an eternal inheritance.
Amen.
And may you, who have already risen with Christ in baptism through faith, by living in a right manner on this earth, be united with him in the homeland of heaven. Come down on you and remain with you forever.